Howdy,
gentlemen. Howdy, Mayor.
Well, Andy, what's this man doing here?
Well, Frank, he's the subject of this meeting.
Well, we already passed on his case, and the matter's closed. You did evict him, didn't you?
Yeah, I did do that.
Well, there's nothing more to talk about. Now, Andy, we're busy men. We don't have time to discuss Frank Myers anymore.
I think we're going to have to find time to discuss Frank Myers. A lot of time.
Mayor, you see this right here?
Yeah?
That's a bond issued by the city of Mayberry back in 1861.
So, what about it?
Well, it's in the amount of $100. It's owned by Frank Myers, and it's due and payable upon presentation by the owner, and Frank's presenting it.
All right, so what is it? It's $100. You're the town treasurer, Harlan. Go on and pay it. Don't bother us about it.
I can't.
Why can't you?
You see, this is a bond that pays 8.5% interest.
Yeah?
Compounded annually.
Yeah?
For over 100 years.
Well, come on, come to the point, man.
Andy.
Well, Mayor, the point is, according to the computation machines down at the bank, and they're good machines, we, that is the town of Mayberry, we owe Frank Myers $349,119.27.
How can we owe that much?
Over a quarter of $1,000,000.
I'll take it in cash.
Well, in that case, gentlemen, the town of Mayberry doesn't owe this man a penny.
Don't you see?
We were so blind not to realize it before. At the time this bond was bought, Mayberry was in the Confederacy.
Which means that that bond was bought with Confederate money.
Which means it can only be paid back in Confederate money.
Which means it's worthless.
See, I know you've been missing the Andy Griffith clips, so it's about time you got one. All right. So I want to tell you about a little restaurant up the road here in Eflin. There's a restaurant, if you haven't tried it, it's the kind of restaurant you just don't go to by yourself. Meaning, you just don't drive by and say, that looks like a nice place. Let's go see what's in there. It's the kind of restaurant that you would ignore. And yet, there's something about it. You see all of these people that are standing outside, with their hands in their pockets, and they're separated and all. And it used to be picnic tables right out there, and you'd see people eating and all. It's called Missy's Grill. But before I want to tell you this, the food there is quite, shall we say, very value-driven. You can get, like, go on and get bacon on that cheeseburger because you can afford it. You know, bacon, cheeseburger. Go on and get a hot dog, too, and a drink. And fries, and you will still do that for less than $10. But there's one catch. Missy's does not accept credit cards. You need to know that going in, because if you're like me, most of the time, 99% of the time, you don't have a nickel in your pocket, but you just got a credit card you can buy stuff with. There's this thing called legal tender. What's acceptable? The term legal tender comes from a French term, and tender means to offer. It's what's offered. And the definition of legal tender is any currency in any culture that is accepted to pay a debt. So if you offer this currency, whatever that currency might be, if you're in Israel, I would highly recommend offering shekels. Shekels is the legal tender there that they will accept for debts. So if you offer that, they will accept that. Depending on where you are, that money or that currency will be accepted as debt. And it's important. And sometimes you end up going to a restaurant with a friend. Make sure you choose your friends wisely. Make sure that you go to a restaurant with a friend that you know has cash on you. Because it's really, really, really bad if you go to a restaurant and they don't accept credit cards and you don't have any cash. And that's all they accept. Missy's is a nice place to go. In fact, I took Gail there one time. Now, Gail preferred Outback and Olive Garden, but you know, Missy's is just right up there with those. Outback and Olive Garden will accept credit cards. I know that. Have you ever asked yourself, what's the legal tender that God accepts? What's the currency that God deals in? We used to take our kids to, Cameron not so much, but the others, we would take them to Chuck E. Cheese. Remember Chuck E. Cheese? You go there and you're playing all these games and it's just spitting out these tickets. And you got like a billion tickets there and you find out it can buy a straw. You know, but it's that type of thing. And of course the kids are all excited but they got to spend. The only place you can spend those tickets is in Chuck E. Cheese. That's the only place it's acceptable. The only place that legal tender, that those tickets act as legal tender, is in Chuck E. Cheese. What does God accept? What does God accept as payment? What does God accept in order to pay a debt that you and I owe Him? We've been in the book of Philippians. And in the book of Philippians, the Apostle Paul is writing from prison. He's writing from Rome. And they have sent a messenger, Epaphroditus, to him, to try to minister to him. His presence has been a ministry to Paul, but also the finances with which Epaphroditus brought the Apostle Paul was a great ministry to him. And so Paul, during this time, will write letters, and he's awaiting trial in Rome. And they want to know about his condition. What are things like in Rome? And he has basically been telling them things about what's happening in Rome. He's told them that people are preaching the gospel, and some people preach it to try to cause him harm, to try to make things rough on him. And some people preach the gospel to the people in Rome to try to expand the gospel, and they preach it out of pure motives. And he says, you know, it's hard to complain because Christ is preached. And he talks also in chapter 1 and verse 28, he talks about people that are trying to make things tough on the Philippians. And I think he's talking about the outsiders, that the fact that the Philippian church is trying to stand in a culture, a Roman culture in Philippi, and that there are people that would love to see that church go away. And there are pressures that are exerted on that church from the outside that would seek to sideline that church and sideline that ministry. But for the most part, in chapters 1 through 2, the Apostle Paul is talking about things from Rome and his perspective. And he gives them that perspective. In fact, at the end of chapter 2, he says, here's what I hope to do. He says, I hope to come to see you. He says, and I think that's going to happen very soon. And I want to send Timothy to you. I want to go from here to there, from where I am to where you are. But I'm going to have to send Epaphroditus back to you. And he talks about listen to him and know that he was a minister to me, and he was an encouragement to me, and just thank you so much for his presence. He almost died accomplishing the objective that you sent him here to do, but he didn't. Thank you for sending him here to me. And so we start chapter 3. In chapter 3, now that he's talked about things from my place, Rome, now he's going to talk about how things are going at your place. What are some things at your place that you need to be concerned about? And so he's going to deal with one of those big times. And it's something that affects the church today. And it affects us today because people desire to be religious. It is within the human heart to do something to be religious. And Paul is going to deal with that. And we'll get right into it. In chapter 3, verse 1, here's what the Apostle Paul says. He says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. Now, another way to say this, it wasn't like finally, I'm ending my letter here. Another way to say this is furthermore, or in any case, and no matter what happens as far as me coming back, Timothy coming back, Epaphroditus coming back there, in any case, rejoice in the Lord. In other words, regardless of your circumstances, regardless of the situation you find yourself in, understand the Philippian church, you have a relationship with God, and you need to rejoice in the Lord about that. You need to understand that no matter where you find yourself, you can have joy in the Lord because of who He is, because of what He's done. And he goes on to say, to write the same things again is no trouble to me. He's getting ready to tell them something. And he says, and it is a safeguard for you. So I'm going to repeat something I told you when I was back there 10 years ago. And I'm going to write down something that Epaphroditus is going to tell you. Because this is so important. So I'm going to write it down now. You've heard it. It's like, you know, tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them. And that's exactly what the Apostle Paul is doing here. He says this is a safeguard for you. That word safeguard, it actually comes, the way they put that word together, was it comes from tripping or stumbling. Well, what do you mean safeguard? How can it come from that? Because this means the opposite of that. A lot of times you take a word and you put the opposite of that. It's like the anti-tripping, the anti-stumbling. So what the Apostle Paul is saying here to the Philippians is, I am going to write these things to you so that you don't stumble, so that you don't trip, so that in your living and in your walking and in your daily routine, you don't find yourself flat on the floor, face planted in the ground. That's why I'm going to tell you the things I'm going to tell you now. And just like there were enemies on the outside, there are some enemies that come into the church or seek to be into the church. And that's who he's going to talk about next. So the things he's going to write is to keep them from stumbling, and he's going to lay that list on out. So here's the first group that he's going to talk about. Beware. Watch out. Be on high alert. Rod, I know I have to be on high alert against pagans and heathens, and you know, but if people have a fish on their car, you know, it's like it's like the guy was driving down I-40 and he was weaving in and out of traffic and he was doing about 85 or 90 miles an hour. Finally the trooper just took right off after him. And he's just blowing by, going by people. You know, he pulls him over and he arrests him. He takes him down to Chapel Hill. He books him, mugshot, fingerprints, everything. And a little bit later, this guy's in jail, and he says, "What in the world did I do? And the cop came back, the trooper came back, and he lets him out of jail. He says, "I am so sorry. It was my mistake. He said, "What was going on? Well, you didn't even let me get a word out." He said, "Well, you were driving 85 miles an hour. You had a K-Love bumper sticker on the back of your car. You had a fish on the back of your car. And you had a Sunrise Church bumper sticker. The only thing I could assume was the car was stolen." I mean, that's the way, in other words, you make the assumption that there are a certain group of people that you can trust. And there's a certain group of people you can't trust. But there's a certain group of people you can trust. The Apostle Paul says, hold on now. Hold on. In fact, here's what he's going to call. Look at the words that he uses to call these religious people. The people he's going to talk about are Jews who had come to a saving knowledge of Christ. That's my belief. They've come to a saving knowledge of Christ. And they're from Jerusalem, so they've put the story together, and they looked at their Jewishness, and they said, "We're something pretty special." In fact, other people should know how special we are. In fact, other churches should know how special we are. And so they ended up following the Apostle Paul. Wherever Paul went and would plant a church, they would soon, after Paul left, they would soon kind of come in and slide in there. And they would say a message like this: "The Apostle Paul told you about Jesus Christ, who came to this earth, lived a perfect life, died on a cross, was buried in a tomb, the third day rose from the dead, ascended into heaven. And he paid for your sin debt. That is fantastic." But the Apostle Paul didn't want to give you the hard part. He didn't want to give you the whole story. The Apostle Paul gave you about 95%. But he didn't give you the other 5%. And the other 5% is a little difficult, but You'll like it. It's good stuff. And they would begin to lay out the Jewish law, when they had to worship, the things about the feast that they would need to observe, the things they would need to do to become good Jews, all the religious stuff they began packing on. And people would say, well, it sounds okay to me. Sounds pretty good. And people would buy into that. And the Apostle Paul in this passage warns them, no, don't do that. And here's the way he begins this. Beware of the dogs. Now, sometimes as guys are around and you dog you know, and they're buddies and they can talk to each other. Paul's not a buddy here. And the term he uses for dogs, in fact, this is a great reversal that's happening here. The Jews thought of the Gentiles as dogs, and they thought of them not as house pets, but as dogs that roamed around wild, would eat anything, would attack people. These dogs had no manners. And the Jews thought of the Gentiles that way because the Jews knew they had a heavenly Father. The Jews had the law, the Word of God. The Jews knew they had been delivered from Egypt. The Jews knew their history. The Gentiles didn't. And so what the Apostle Paul is saying here, he says, these Jewish people consider the Gentiles dogs. He says, but beware of the dogs. They are dogs. He says, beware of the evil workers, because what they're going to try to sell you is good works. They're going to try to peddle good works to you. They're going to try to peddle good religious works to you. He says, but these people, they're evil workers. They're evil workers. Beware of the false circumcision. And that's not the best way to translate that. Because he doesn't even use the term of circumcision here. He says, it's beware of the mutilators. Beware of the people that want to mutilate the flesh. Because, you know, that hard part of the message that they had was, guys, you need to get circumcised. Now, if you really want to be a real good Christian, here's what you do. You go to church on Sunday, I understand. You go to church on, but also go on Saturday. Go on Saturday and Sunday. And you celebrate all of these feasts. You celebrate all of the feasts. The feast of the Passover. You celebrate the feast of the first fruits. The feast of Pentecost. You celebrate all of these. You got to celebrate these. The new moon. All of these things. If you really want to be religious. And guys, you got to get circumcised. You got to get circumcised. So you do that and you will prove by your good works that you are truly a believer, that you truly love God, because you've proved it by your good works, and God will accept that as legal tender. And the Apostle Paul is calling BS on that. You know what BS stands for? Barbara Streisand. Anyway, he will call BS on that. This passage is so strong that in the English, all the commentaries will tell you, in the English, we can't, the anger and the vitriol towards religion that Paul has here, he's not holding back anything. Beware the dogs. Beware the evil workers. Beware of the false circumcision. Beware of the mutilators. Because here's what they do. They are coming in and they're going to accuse you, Gentile church, the Philippians. They're going to look at you like you're a dog. They're going to look at you like you're doing evil works. They're going to look at you like you aren't circumcised. I hate to admit this, but there's a Pee Wee Herman movie, okay? And there's a scene in Pee Wee Herman's movie where the guy calls him something, some name or something. You're an idiot. And Pee Wee Herman says, I know I am, but what do you, I know you are, but what am I? Well, I know you are, but what am I? I know you are, but whatever the person says about the other person, they're reflecting what they are. And the Apostle Paul says, I know you are, but what am I? And he says, I'm going to tell you what I am. Philippian church, I'm going to tell you what you are. He says, verse 3, for we are the true circumcision, We're not mutilators. He uses a different word here. We're not mutilators of the flesh. We're the true circumcision. And how do you know that? Because of three things. He says, number one, we worship in the Spirit of God. We don't worship by works. We worship in spirit, by the Spirit of God. In the Gospel of John, Jesus will tell people, those that worship must worship Him. God is spirit, and those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. We worship in the Spirit of God. And we glory in Christ Jesus. Another translation says, we take pride in Christ Jesus. We glory in Christ Jesus. What are these people coming in trying to sell religion to the Philippian church? What are they taking pride in? Their flesh, their rules, their obedience. That's what they're glorying in. He says, we glory in Christ Jesus. And thirdly, he says, we don't put any confidence in the flesh. We don't go around saying, look at how good we are. Look at all our bumper stickers. Look at all the things. Look at the way we dress. Look at all our crosses. You know, I have my class ring has a cross in it. It's a little thing. But people have looked at my class ring and said, oh, there's a cross in there. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. You know what would be wrong if I had the attitude, why doesn't your class ring have a cross in it? I must be really special because my class ring has a cross in it. That type of attitude can seep into a church, can seep in to a denomination, and can utterly destroy it. It eats it. It's like a cancer. It eats it from within. And that's what the Apostle Paul is saying here. We're the true circumcision because we worship in spirit and we glory in Christ and we put no confidence in the flesh. And then he does something kind of a switcheroo where he says, hey, you want to put confidence in the flesh? I'm not saying this because I can't match up. I'm not saying this because I have bad habits. I'm not telling you and warning you about this because I don't know any better. He says, although I myself might have confidence even in the flesh. He says, if you want to play that game, big boys, I can play this game. And he goes on and he begins to describe his life. And here's what he says. If anyone else has a mind to put confidence in the flesh, I far more. You want to match degrees? You want to match circumstances? And he goes down here and he gives a resume of what he had before he came to Christ. He says, I was circumcised on the eighth day. And the idea here is you're supposed to be circumcised on the eighth day. That's the ideal day to be circumcised if you were a Jewish boy. To be circumcised, to be taken into the community, to be part of the faith community, the Jewish faith community. Now, does that mean if you missed the eighth day, no good? No, but what it meant is the eighth day was the day. You might have to do it on the ninth day, or the tenth day, or the 11th day, or the 12th day. But he says, I was circumcised on the eighth day. Now, think about if you're a Philippian. If you're in Philippi and you're male. Think about if you're 30 years old. And you're starting to say, man, I just don't feel adequate. I feel like there's got to be something more Christ wants from me. I think I need to get circumcised. And the wife is sitting there going, you know. And you sit there, and no matter how hard you work, if you're 35 years old, if you're 20 years old, if you're 15 years old, if you're 10 years old, you'll never be on the eighth day. You'll never be good enough. Paul says, I was good enough. There were things at work in my life before I even knew it, before I could even act. There were things that were being positioned for me. On the eighth day, I was circumcised. I was of the nation of Israel. I was of the tribe of Benjamin. I was born at the right place, to the right people, at the right time, being circumcised on the right day. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. The message that these religious people are coming in and trying to sell the church of works, of doing good works, of adding, of adding to your salvation, which is free and clear of good works, is a bunch of bull. As to the law, I was a Pharisee. How did I relate to the Word of God? I related by studying it. See, Philippians, you are being tempted to buy in to these people. And the fact of the matter is, no matter how much you want to buy in, you will never be able to get to where I was. And quite frankly, they will not either. They can't match what I was. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. This not only affected me, I not only had a resume of this, I acted on it. And I went to persecute the church because in my mind, the church has stood up and usurped the authority of the Word of God. And they were teaching something contrary to what the Old Testament taught. So Paul thought. He says, as to the righteousness which is in the law found blameless. Wow. He was a zealot for the love of God, for the love of God's word, for the love of God's people. And he was blameless as it related to law. He had gotten that curriculum. He had worked that curriculum. He had done everything that curriculum told him to do. And he says, what's the next verse? He says, but whatever things were gained to me, those things I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Philippians, the things you are running to, the things you're being tempted by, are things I had. And I gave it all up. I counted them as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value. What we're talking about is here is value. What does God value? What does God look at and what does He value? What is legal tender when it comes to your relationship with God? He says all of this is lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. He says, I've been through it. I'm in jail right now because of this. I've suffered all of these things and count them but rubbish. In other words, Paul says, as I'm sitting here, as I look at what I had, and as I look at what I've lost, all of those things are rubbish, are nothing. It's interesting what people will value. My brother and I, one of the most traumatic moments in our lives, we were three, not quite four. Mom and Dad had gotten married. He was my stepfather. And we were going around. I guess Mom did not want to take the baby bottle away from me and my brother. So I'm a three-year-old with a baby bottle walking around, just hanging out. I was almost four. And one day it happened. It was time to break the Cheney boys off the baby bottle. Whoa! The neighborhood knew something had happened. They scalding them kids. Something had called. The police called somebody. We cried and cried and cried. Later, my mom told me she was in bed. And she said, Bobby, please let me get up. Please let me get up. She couldn't handle it. She couldn't handle it. I mean, we cried. I'm talking about hours and hours and hours. This was traumatic. I remember it like it was yesterday. About a year goes by, a little more than a year, and my brother and I have been told, don't go under the sink. The door's underneath the sink. And the reason why, my brother, in his brilliance, had drank some Pine Sol one time. That's not good. It's not good to do that. So Pine Sol is underneath the sink. Whatever, do not open the doors to underneath the sink there. But we're at that age to where, you know, we know more than our parents know. You know, at 5 years old, you know a lot as a kid. We open underneath the sink. And what's sitting right there? Our two baby bottles. Mama was scared to throw them away because she thought we might have to revert back to them. I kid you not. My brother and I grabbed them. The The thing that it cost us so much consternation, so much pain and loss, we looked at it at 5 years. We were big boys now. We didn't even have any diapers on now, you know? You don't have any diaper, what do you need a baby bottle for? What do you need a pacifier for? And that's the attitude that Paul has here. He says, all of those things that people say, oh, poor Paul. Poor Paul. Paul had position. Paul was going to be one of the top, if not the top guy in all of Israel. He had position. He studied under the right teachers. He had all of the information there. He had checked all the boxes. His resume, his CV was incredible. And Paul said, I lost all of it. And I count it as rubbish. That doesn't hold a drop to what I have in Christ. And I count them as rubbish so that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. And so people could see me and they would see Christ, that my identity is so identified with Christ and what He's done for me. And he goes on, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law. The righteousness I have is not from me and what I could do. The righteousness that the outsiders coming into the Philippian church are trying to sell you is a righteousness that you can try. You won't get there, but you can try to own, and it can be yours. I got this righteousness. I'm good enough. And if you're ever around religious people that start telling you all the things they do and don't do, ask yourself, whose righteousness are they really trusting in? How far can that hand go back there to pat themselves on the back? The Apostle Paul here, he's saying, I don't have a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God, the righteousness I've experienced is the righteousness that is a gift, that is a gift, that is a gift. That's a gift. During this time of year, we ought to know the difference between something you earn and something that's a gift, something that you work for and something that's given to you. And Paul says, I earned a whole lot of things that a lot of people would be impressed by, but this is a gift. And the righteousness that I experience is a gift. And it comes from God on the basis of faith. Of faith. And there are people trying to sell you something. There are people trying to get you to do something. There's people trying to give you a checklist. And you're going to be so frustrated. And you're going to stumble. And you're going to face plant. And the reason why is because that is not legal tender. Your works are not legal tender. Faith is legal tender in the economy of God. It is faith. And then he says that I may know him. And he's talking about knowing him personally. That I may know him, that he's a friend, that he's somebody I know, that I can know the things he would do, the way he would answer questions, that I would know the actions that he would take, that I may know him, and I will know the power of his resurrection, his power that brought forth the resurrection. His power did something that nobody else can do. Nuclear power can't do it. Fossil fuels can't do it. Solar power can't do it, which is raise people from the dead. That's the power I want to know. And the fellowship of his sufferings. When I am in prison here and I go through the beatings that he had suffered at Philippi, when I experience all that, the fact of the matter is, I realize, wow, Christ went through this same type of thing for me. Being conformed to his death in order that I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Now, we're going to pick up here next week and develop this further, but I want to tell you, because commentaries don't know what this means. In verse 11, in order that, and some of your translation says, that somehow I might. And people put out there that Paul is talking about humility here, that I don't know how God's going to do it, but I will be part of the resurrection. I know the resurrection is going to happen. I know I will be raised from the dead because of the promises of God. I know that, but I don't know how it's going to happen. I'm going to walk out on a short limb here and tell you what I think's going on here. Okay? Come back next week because I might say, nah, what I said last week didn't work. He uses a different word for resurrection here than he does in verse 10. In verse 10, and I'm going to say this word wrong, I remember it by Anastasia. It's Anastasia. That's the word. You know, like Anastasia, you know, the girl's name, the movie, the cartoon movie, and other movies. He uses the word resurrection in verse 10, Anastasia. In verse 11, he uses the word Anastasia, but he adds something to it. And it's the only time it's used in the whole New Testament. It's ex Anastasia. It's ex Anastasia. It means out of the resurrection. That somehow I may obtain out of the resurrection from the dead. Here's what I think he's talking about. And we're going to talk about this more next week. I think what he's talking about is to know Christ, to know the fellowship of his suffering, to be so closely related to him that out of this death, his faith and focus on Christ will allow him to live out the resurrection, that he may attain, come to the point where he lives out the resurrection in this realm, in this now. Anticipating the resurrection that is going to come, but that he would so know God and so know Christ and by his faith so understand that what God has done for him, that he makes decisions and he lives out his resurrection. And he's going to say, not that I've already attained that. He's going to pick it up next week. But he strives to that point. He works to that point. I was in a meeting some years ago, it's probably 3 years ago, I was in a meeting, and a guy by the name of Oz Guinness was speaking. Oz Guinness is an English thinker, he's written several books and all. And he told us the story that just a few months earlier, a guy by the name of John R.W. Stott had passed away. Dr. Stott was one of the premier preachers in England and, quite frankly, America. He was the Queen's vicar, I guess you would say. He had, I don't know all those fancy names and all. The most valued book I own, to me personally, is his preaching book that I got him to sign when I met him back in 1987. I got him to sign my preaching book, John R.W. Stott. Faithful minister of the Word of God. And Oz Guinness visits John R.W. Stott on his deathbed. And when Oz visits him, he says, John, how can I pray for you? How can I pray for you? And John Stott, who'd never been married, who'd been a faithful minister of the gospel of Christ, said, pray that I would be faithful. Pray that I would be faithful. And what he was saying is that I want to live out the resurrection before he takes me home. He didn't count it as a done deal that he would live that out. Now, he didn't think that he would lose his salvation. Because his salvation is not determined on the works, on being religious. He said, pray that I can be faithful. And when I heard that illustration, I thought about this passage right here. Where the Apostle Paul is saying, pray that I can live out the resurrection from the dead. Legal tender. What do you use for legal tender? I got a $5 on me. I got a $2. Have you ever gone in? I carry a $2 bill in my wallet. And the reason I do that, it's because it has the signing of the Declaration of Independence on the back. But several years ago, the $2 bills were quite popular. Have you ever gone to try to pay something with a $2 bill? Clerk looks at you. I ain't taking that. We don't take no funny money here. It's legal tender that they won't accept. The fact of the matter is, if you are using your works to try to impress God, to try to in some way get on God's right side, that's not counted as legal tender. He's not taking works as legal tender. He's taking faith. Your faith. in your faith. And for some people, that's just way too simple. Dim's the way the cookie crumbles. It's faith. You take it up with Him. Father, may we understand and realize and walk in the reality of knowing Christ and walk in the reality of fellowship with Him. And may the pressure of religious people to try to conform us to a religious mold be shattered in our thinking. And may we strive to know Christ, the fellowship of His suffering, the righteousness that He has purchased for all of us. In Christ's name, I offer this prayer.